But first, our special series, Stopping Superbugs. This week, science correspondent Miles O'Brien and economics correspondent Paul Solman tag team again for a look at how the use of antibiotics in livestock can lead to unhealthy, even dangerous outcomes. Miles begins at a Missouri pig farm as part of our weekly science series, Leading Edge.
Pig farmer Russ Kramer is up early, tending to his herd, talking to the animals.
I have the ability to interact with pigs. I think that they are the smartest, most social animals. I tell people that if you like kids, you love pigs.
He is the fifth generation in the Kramer clan to farm this plot of land in Frankenstein, Missouri. He introduced me to the newest residents.
Everything that we do on this farm, as far as feeding and as far as production, as far as genetics, all has to do with keeping them healthy.
Russ Kramer is obsessed with keeping his pigs healthy because he knows firsthand that his own health depends on it.
That's about as good as it's going to get.
30 years ago, the farmer from Frankenstein created a monster after he adopted industrial farming techniques to increase his pig production.
My pigs were unhealthy. I would go through my pig pens three times a day, injecting them with antibiotics to cure some sort of chronic diseases that I had on my place. And, in fact, I was actually growing superbugs on this farm and didn't know it.
How he found out nearly killed him. He was gored in the leg by a boar, and the wound became infected. His doctor told him not to worry. Antibiotics were the cure. But it wasn't that simple.
We tried two different tetracyclines, we tried streptomycin, we tried erythromycin, amoxicillin, seven different antibiotics in total, to no avail.
So he checked the reports from his veterinarian to see what infections his pigs had and what antibiotics worked for them.
It came back, resistant, and finally, aha, there was one antibiotic at that time that had some effect on that disease. They treated me, and thank God there was this new generation drug. And so that transformed my life.
This is what we call a colony.
So molecular microbiologist Lance Price also grew up on a farm, a cattle ranch. He watched firsthand as a neighboring dairy went from a small-scale family operation to a high-density industrial-scale farm. They are called concentrated animal feeding operations. Lance Price says they are fertile breeding grounds for disease.
You pack them together, snout to tail in the case of pigs, and beak to feather in the case of chickens and turkeys. They're going to share bacteria. So we've engineered a system that makes them sick. Rather than change that system, we actually just add low doses of antibiotics to try to prevent infections.
Price and his team at George Washington University conduct large epidemiological studies of meat that is sold in grocery stores. They culture the bacteria found on the meat and test to see how they react to discs saturated with antibiotics. He is hunting for superbugs.
If they're susceptible, that is not resistant to the antibiotic, they will be inhibited. They won't grow near the disc. But when they grow right up to the disc, like all of these, that means that that bacteria is resistant to all those antibiotics. Mm-hmm. You don't want to get infected with one of these. And these are bacteria that we actually isolated from the food supply.
He sequences the genomes of E. coli from food and from people, comparing them to a database of 7,000 distinct types of the bacteria.
We're trying to figure out, hey, did this urinary tract infection come from the, E. coli from animals or from food?
He says there is a strong case linking the use of antibiotics in livestock to the spread of drug-resistant bacteria in humans.
So on every grocery store shelf in this country, I guarantee you're going to find drug-resistant bacteria on the meats of those shelves. And then they get in our guts when we consume the meat from those animals. Most of the time, that's a dead end, right? We will eventually get rid of those bacteria. We'll shed them away. But sometimes they'll take hold.
In the 1950s, farmers discovered feeding livestock steady, low doses of antibiotics made them grow faster. But this so-called subtherapeutic use of these precious drugs raised concern in the medical community and the government. In 1977, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration proposed a ban on subtherapeutic uses of penicillin and tetracycline in animal production. But the rule was never enacted, and the problem worsened. In 1989, human and livestock usage of antibiotics was about equal. Today, agriculture accounts for about three-quarters of all the antibiotics used in the United States.
We have to stop now. We have to stop abusing them now so that we can slow this problem down.
Mei Wu is a senior attorney at the Natural Resources Defense Council.
Using antibiotics and misusing them just to make animals get fatter, or so you can cram more together and have more stressful conditions and feed them worse diets, is the worst way to be using these incredibly important drugs.
In 2010, the NRDC sued the FDA to force it to adopt its own rule.
The Food and Drug Administration is changing the status of many antimicrobials used in feed.
Instead, it released new regulations limiting the use of medically important antibiotics in animals to when it is necessary for assuring animal health and with veterinary oversight and/or consultation. Liz Wagstrom is the chief veterinarian at the National Pork Producers Council.
The pork industry believes that the most judicious uses of antibiotics are those for treatment, control, and prevention of diseases.
Wagstrom says the pork industry will follow the FDA guidance, but she says pork producers will continue to use antibiotics as a routine disease prevention tool, even if there are no illnesses detected in their livestock.
It is a judicious and responsible use of antibiotics to go ahead and prophylactically treat some of those animals when we know they're exposed, we know that it's a specific disease, and we're going to use that antibiotic for a defined duration of use.
This is a huge loophole, as my colleague Paul Solman discovered in his conversation with Johns Hopkins University environmental health scientist Ellen Silbergeld.
What has been stated as the recommendations, not enforceable policy, by the FDA is that agriculture should not use antibiotics for growth promotion anymore. But they're still permitted to use the exact same amounts of antibiotics in feeds for prevention. So I think the category of prevention now has blown up.
No need to worry about this at Russ Kramer's farm in Frankenstein, Missouri. His pigs do not spend their life confined indoors, cheek to jowl. They have much more space, easy access to pastures, even a wooded area Kramer calls his pig park. He's trying to mimic what pigs would find in nature.
This is the best place in America to raise pigs in my mind.
Right here.
Right here.
He rarely uses antibiotics at all, and then only if an animal is sick. Antibiotics saved Russ Kramer's life 30 years ago. Today, he's doing all he can to return the favor.
They're lifesavers, and what we have to ingrain in the people's mind and society's mind is we have to do everything we can to preserve them. It's the most important, the most critical health issue in the world, and I'm here to do whatever I can.
After I got back from Frankenstein, I sat down with Paul Solman to share some anecdotes from Russ Kramer's bucolic pig farm.
So Russ Kramer was ahead of his time, but the market has kind of caught up to what he is doing. It's still a small piece of the big pie. Just a few thousand are raised in the way Russ does them. So the question is it scalable?
Well, in chickens, producers claim that 30% of the market, something like that, the chickens are raised antibiotics free. So that's where we're going next, actually. That's our next story. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm economics correspondent Paul Solman.
And I'm science correspondent Miles O'Brien.